The question that I have always been plagued with is that I have had the opportunity to try to figure out what the hell to do now. You think that's easy? It's not easy for any of us. I have a friend of mine, Master Sergeant. Four tours in Iraq, one tour in Afghanistan. E8 down at Fort Benning in the Warrior Transition Unit, whatever the hell that is. Right? Well, can you imagine the self-image problems of being in a Warrior Transition Unit? Well, my friend down there is in his Warrior Transition Unit. And he tells me over the last 6 months, 5 suicides have occurred. That is not funny. That's not a laughing matter. So, in so many ways, Vietnam veterans, and now to a certain extent anybody who goes to the war, but Vietnam veterans in particular, have had to try to figure this out on their own. Why the hell did I go? What the hell did I do? Why didn't it work out better? And now I'm alive. I'm on this side of the wall. Now what am I going to do with my life? Well, I came to that point in 1970, spring of 1970. Chris, no kidding. It's a joke, but it's kind of not a joke because it was reality. I said, no job, no future, no girlfriend, no money, no car. Now's a great time to run for the state senate. Politics became my coping mechanism, my own coping mechanism. It was my way of answering the question, what the hell am I going to do now? How am I going to make meaning out of this? Viktor Frankl, V-I-K-T-O-R, Viktor Frankl, F-R-A-N-K-E-L, survived the Nazi death camp. He had 1 out of 28 chances of survival, but he survived. But he was a psychiatrist from Vienna, Austria, before World War II. He came out, wrote a book called Man's Search for Meaning. He developed a whole new part of psychiatry, which was if you answer the question, if you get that client, that constituent, that wounded warrior, whatever, to come up with a sense of meaning and purpose and destiny and direction in their life, they're not psychotic anymore. They're not up anymore. They're all right. They're working on meaning and purpose in their life. But we all struggle with that. At least I do. And it changes from time to time. One day, I got it all figured out. The next day, I forget where I put it. You know, that's just the way it is. We can't figure all this stuff out on our own. We can't figure out this thing called life. We can't figure out this thing called wounded. We can't figure out this thing called war. We can't figure out this thing called survival on our own. We need the grace of God and the help of friends. Now, when I was head of the Veterans Administration, back in '06, okay, for near the Spanish-American War, if you know your American history, I was there. But I was there in the late 70s. It was painfully obvious that Vietnam veterans, en masse, to a certain extent, were struggling with emotional issues of war. It shouldn't be a surprise, not a surprise now. Now we call it post-traumatic stress disorder. Actually, it was called post-traumatic stress disorder in 1978 by being psychiatrists. Now the new term is post-traumatic stress. If you didn't have post-traumatic stress after a stressful event, then you're crazy. But if you have a healthy mind and you have post-traumatic stress, that means you're sane as hell. You're just dealing with the stress that your body and mind and spirit have gone through. So, after I lost in 2003, I wound up with Brother Miller's vet center down here at Silver Spring. War catches up with you. Wars are not over when the shooting stops. They live on in the lives of people who serve them. That is one thing you can count on. So why should post-traumatic stress be news to us? When I was at the VA, it was news. It wasn't recognized as a compensable disability or any kind of disability at all until 1978. Then lo and behold, the VA psychiatrist says, yes, there's something called post-traumatic stress disorder. So working with President Carter and Senator Cranston of California, we put together something called a vet center. Now why did we put a vet center? Well, we couldn't call it a VA center because Vietnam veterans were so pissed at the VA, they didn't want to have anything to do with the VA. Nothing that said VA on it. So the vet centers were disguised as little community outreach centers like in California. In 1980, we put together the very first vet center in Van Nuys, California. It was in a shopping center, just a little community center. It was they were all paid for by the VA. The materials were made, but they didn't have VA on it. It was disguised. You had disguised, that kind of thing in those days. Well, welcome to Iraq and Afghanistan, 2013. Now, there are over 200 vet centers. There are going to be some 1,600 counselors. The Vietnam generation is phasing out. Out here, you see a wonderful truck. I came up and I saw it. I said, son of a bitch, something good came out of Vietnam War. At that damn vet center program. The 50th anniversary, thank you. But I sure could have used this about 10 or 20 or 30 years after I got back. People come up to me in the airport and say, thank you for your service. I think they think I did serve in Spanish America. Maybe they think because I'm a multiple amputee or something, I came right out and went off to Afghanistan. So. 2 or 3 weeks ago, I celebrated 45 years of the grenade going off. Jim Mayer was in the audience, and Jim Mayer's here. Later this month, he celebrates his 133rd anniversary. Jim Mayer celebrates his Alive Day. I got the concept of Alive Day from a fellow Vietnam veteran, Jim Mayer. Because I avoided the very notion of being blown up or wounded in Vietnam. I wanted to ignore it. I passed it by for years. But then I came down to the VA, Jim was there, and he would raise hell, get drunk, get naked with his friends. I said, that's the kind of life I want. So the concept of Alive Day comes from Jim Mayer, and he's passed that on in so many wonderful ways to Iraq and Afghan veterans. I have a friend of mine, helicopter pilot, two tours, the Distinguished Flying Cross, secret missions into Cambodia, you know the whole routine. He told me today, he's a retired lieutenant colonel, 75 years of age. He said, well, you know, he said, on Memorial Day, I think I'll put my dress blues in. He's only worn his uniform three times in about 50 years. But this coming Memorial Day, he's going to put on his dress blues. He's going to go to church. And anybody that don't like it can just kiss his hands. Because finally, he has a pride that he had never known.